on much shorter timescales, but it's still it involves binaries and singles. And I'm gonna put it in a way that I'm gonna describe. So the main question that I'm asking in this talk that I'm gonna center my talk around is how to tell the difference between different merchant channels. So I raised that question a little bit yesterday. We got a few proposed also this morning, but how do we actually tell the difference? As you already know, if you have a black hole, you look at it, it's characterized by its mass and its spin. It don't tell you anything about how it formed. Did it form through multiple mergers of smaller black holes? Was it a massive star? Was it two stars that you know formed in a binary and one of the black holes turned out to be that one you're looking at? Or how did that black hole actually form? When you just look at the black hole, it will not tell you about that, right? So how do we actually tell the difference between different merger channels when we only look at gravitational wave signals? And I'm just gonna pick up from some of the artistic figures. Well, I think the only one that's really artistic are one down to the right and down to the left. The other ones are real pictures of regions of our universe. And you can imagine so many ways that binary black holes can merge in our universe. And we heard from Smadar this morning, you can have binaries around the supermassive black holes in the center of galaxies. And you can also imagine, so this is the case you was talking about. We have a supermassive black hole here, and even in that case, you can imagine so many different ways. You know, how do I get the binaries there? What are the masses? What are the inclinations? What about other binaries nearby? And so many things, right? And you can expand the same, challenges to so many other regions of the universe. In this talk here, I'll be talking about the formation of mergers in very dense stellar systems, right? And I want to contrast that to some of the merger channels or one of the main merger channels people have been talking about is where you just have two stars forming next to each other, turn into black holes, and then they merge, right? And those two channels are relevant because you see globular clusters on the sky. You don't see primordial black holes as you see down to the right. We don't see them in the sky. They're not constrained very well. Well, they are, and they're constrained to a level where I don't think there are certain mass ranges where they certainly cannot be. They have been constrained, for example, through microlensing. But globular clusters we observe, the density there of stars is very, very high. If we think that there might be black holes in these very dense stellar systems, it's very easy to argue that these black holes falls to the center, they strongly interact, and then they might form binary black hole mergers, and we're going to talk about that process here. And as I said, the whole challenge is that what we have is the gravitational wave signal. And for most mergers, we don't have EM counterparts, we don't have where they are in the sky, is very poorly localized. So this is what we have to work with. So how do we tell the difference between merger channels? And that's some of the things that I'm looking, thinking about it, and many, many other people on the astrophysical side. We heard a little bit about yesterday from how you can test GR and so forth. But the astrophysical background, it's a different question, and in some cases much more rich. So I will just take one perspective on that here. So what you can have here, so as I said, I want to contrast two different merger channels that clearly can give difference to different gravitation wave signals. I just want to hear, can everybody hear me? Because there is a tractor outside that is making a lot of noise. Is it okay that I can close the window? Yeah. Okay, that's a little bit. Okay, sorry to people online. Is it on? Oh yes, it is on. Yeah, I think so. Martin, there is a small problem here with this. Oh, I don't think it's okay. Great. Okay, so we take a look at. So it should be closer to my mouth. Anyway, I think. this is fine, right? Well, that's not, yeah, okay. So let us, so what I said was that we want to contrast, or we're gonna compare two different kind of merger channels. We have the one where the binary black holes are forming clusters, and you have the one where they're forming in the field, right? And we can already, I can argue for a few differences that you might expect here. So in clusters, the black holes that end up merging are, have likely not formed together, right? So you have maybe a few thousand black holes in the clusters to start out with. They undergo exchange interactions. I will show what that is later. They pair up in different ways. Other black holes are coming in. And it's really like a chaos picture of how these binary black holes, they end up merging. So definitely the binary black holes that are merging did not form together. So therefore their relative spin orientation here shown with the red arrows here. So this is the black holes of the spins. They are not correlated. So the distribution of spin that you see will be isotropic, right? Where if you contrast that to the field case, it's a very big chance that the spins of the black holes is somewhat correlated because the two stars form together and they, you know, in the same cloud and rotating the same way and might even have interacted in different ways before they turn into black holes. So there you might expect some correlation between the spin vectors. You might also expect some differences in mass. So one of the results of binary black holes or single black holes interacting with each other and stars in very dense stellar systems is that, as I already said, if something is heavy, it tends to fall to the center, right? So therefore, black holes tend to have more or less the same mass, like the black holes that are in the center at any given time tend to have more or less the same mass because it's the most heavy black holes in your distribution that is in the center. Of course, there's some dispersion to that. On top of that, if you have these scatterings, you always tend to kick out the lightest object. So you tend to go towards a configuration where the binaries have more or less the same masses, right? Where in the isolated field binary case, it's not entirely clear what the mass distribution is. People, of course, working on this, but you don't have, like, you know, you cannot simulate it or argue in the same simple way as in the cluster for why the mass ratio should be close to a certain factor. Okay. Then you also have the eccentricity that you can look at. And yeah, sure. We have a question. Yeah.
Okay.
No, that is a very good question. Yeah, sure. No, it is the mass ratio that's more or less close to one. Yeah. Oh yeah, sure. So the question was that I said that most of the masses, you know, of the merging binary black holes tend to be the same, and it is not the same mass. It is the mass ratio that that is about one. Yeah. So first you burn, as you say, like first you merge the most heavy objects inside your cluster. And then as time goes by, then you get to the lighter object because first all the heavy black holes fall into the center. And once they're kicked out or merged, then you get to the, you know, the less heavy and so forth, right? So if you look at it as a function of time, you actually have an evolution of mass also as a function of redshifts, right? But it's not entirely, you know, it is not one-to-one of how they interact in the center, how they merge, because sometimes they're kicked out and they might not merge within the Hubble time. So if you kick something, you know, a very heavy pair up at very early times, it might not even have merged yet. So, but people can simulate this and they find a mass ratio around one. Yeah. Yeah, we have another question. Yeah. Yeah, basically, yeah. So all of the stellar processes are, you know, especially for the stars that are forming black holes are relatively short compared to the lifetime of these clusters, right? And the relaxation time, like the dynamical time of the cluster itself, like the time it takes for it to reorganize its objects is very, very short. So as I will show later,
you have many episodes of binaries that are forming, interacting, being kicked out, merging, and so forth. You know, hundreds of these episodes during the whole cluster lifetime. Okay. So the eccentricity don't have to be zero when you measure it in LISA, maybe DESIGO, maybe even LIGO, for binary black holes forming in clusters, where if you look into the field, it's very likely that it's very close to zero because you have circularization first from stellar, the tidal evolution and interaction in the stars here. Except, I think I have a figure here, if you have this quasar mechanism that Smadarsi was talking about. Rates and localization is not really something we can use to really tell the difference between formation channels right now. But as I also said, the eccentricity, I just put in this figure also that shows the gravitational wave strain signal for an eccentric merger. And you can, as we talked about yesterday, you can clearly see that it is not a simple sine wave. You easily see this eccentric signal here. So let's take a look a little bit more on the clusters now, right? So what I'm gonna do in the next few slides is to describe to you the recent work that we have been doing on trying to understand how binary black holes actually merge in clusters, and that will also reveal some of the open questions in this field here. So the basic mechanism that I'll come into later that forms binary black holes in clusters are binaries that are forming inside the cluster, and then they undergo scatterings with other black holes. Those scatterings give rise to a classical recoil. That recoil kicks the binaries out of the cluster, and then out of the cluster, they might or might not merge within the Hubble time. That depends on how massive the black holes are, the distribution of eccentricity, and so forth. But of order unity of binary black holes from classical globular clusters will merge outside the cluster, okay, within the Hubble time. And you can then ask, well, what are the properties of these binary black hole mergers when they're merging outside the cluster? And that has been proposed as one of the main merger channels. And for that, I'm going to introduce not only the gravitational wave frequency, as we looked at yesterday, when you have a circular binary black hole, the frequency is about one over the orbital time of your binary. But I'm also going to introduce here the peak, the gravitational wave peak frequency. And that is the peak frequency where most of the power is radiated. And that is not one over the orbital time if you have an eccentric binary. That is closer to one over the orbital time if you assume that the orbit is described by a binary with a semi-major axis having a semi-major axis of the periostender instead of its actually semi-major axis. Okay, you can see here the semi-major axis in this case here can be very, very large, but the periostender distance is very, very small. Therefore, the peak frequency can be very, very high. Okay, so you can easily have, when you have eccentric sources, you can have sources that are showing up in the LIGO band, but with a very, very large semi-major axis, meaning that it's, you know, burst period or it's the orbital time is actually relatively long. Right? So you see like these bursty signals. And if you then map the distribution of peak frequencies as a function of, the peak frequency here for these binary black holes that are kicked out from clusters, then you find that they distribute in this way here. And I'll show you how I do this calculation later. But this is the classical result of how this distributes. And then what happens is that, as you have all learned, when you have a binary black hole, it starts doing its inspiral. It will tend to circularize before it actually goes on really, you know, the final few orbits start merging, right? So what happens here is that in this case here, you can look at this as a capture, single capture. It undergoes a highly eccentric, or you have a bound system that you form through this capture here. You now have a highly eccentric binary. To leading order, the periostender stays constant. It starts to circularize, or it starts to spiral in, but with constant periostender distance, okay? Until it circularizes here, and then it starts to undergo its final inspiral. That is how this works if you write out the change in energy and angular momentum. Okay, so that basically means that a binary black hole, a highly eccentric binary black hole, tend to stay at its peak frequency until it circularizes, and then it starts to drift through the band here to higher frequencies. Okay. So if you have a highly eccentric binary black hole forming here, it will stay more or less highly eccentric on this peak frequency here. Once it has circularized, it does not really have much eccentricity left, then it starts to move to the right. So if you look at LIGO, it's operating out here around 10 Hertz. You see most of these sources here will have circularized before they reach the LIGO band. Okay. But if you take into account various processes that can take place inside the cluster, both in between and during these three body scatterings, and take into account what we denote post-Newtonian effects, I'll come back to that, then you find a much, much richer distribution. Some of them might merge in between the scatterings. We found that to be the green distribution. And many of these, can you see, they will show up in LISA with high centricity. Some of them will undergo or will form through these single captures that I showed you. They will show up eccentric in DCGO, and some of the mergers will actually form during your three body scatterings, and they will show up eccentric in LIGO. Okay. And we have been able and still working on trying to calculate the relative contribution from these different distributions here, depending on the cluster mass, the properties of the cluster, the black holes, and the function of redshift. So really our goal for, our dream is to be able to map out this gravitation wave spectrum with eccentricity over the coming years. But we can already do a lot just with LIGO, because about 5% of all the binary black hole mergers we found will appear eccentric in LIGO from processes that are now gonna go into. Okay, so there are groups that are doing now full Monte Carlo simulations. It's extremely difficult, almost impossible to do full in-body simulations of cluster systems. So one have to find various tricks to solve this problem here. The trick that we do, or the approach that we are doing, are we are assuming a population of binaries inside our clusters. We calculate probabilities or cross sections for different outcomes when those binaries interact with other binaries or other singles. And then we calculate rates based on that, given a dispersion and a density of the cluster, and then we get an idea of what combinations of outcomes and observables that we can expect for these systems. Okay. We have also been doing not only binary black holes and black holes, but those black holes can also interact with stars. They might be able to give rise to some EM counterparts. Unfortunately, many of, like when you start to put in stars and ask, oh, what can I see and where, it will mostly be nearby sources. So what we're really interested in are these binary black hole mergers that we, with 3D observatories within the next decade or two decades, we'll be able to see, 100,000 of these mergers. Okay, so what is our approach? We start with a very dense stellar system here, and then we imagine black holes populating the core, and then we have some stars in the outskirts. And the black holes in the core, the black holes are in the core, because they're much heavier than the stars. They basically sink to the center by scattering out the stars. Now we don't gonna think too much about the stars anymore and focus mostly on the black hole core. And then we're gonna look at the different processes that might be able to create binary black hole mergers in this picture here. Okay. So the first one that we can come up with that we also talked about yesterday is this classical gravitational wave capture. Two black holes, not initially bound to each other, having a positive energy at infinity. Mu here is the reduced mass. I'm sorry, I'm not going through all the different constants and variables here, but the V is the velocity dispersion of your cluster. So you can imagine that's like the kinetic energy of every single pair. And this here is the radiation at one perisinter passage. It depends on the mass of the black hole and the perisinter here. If the radiation at pericenter is greater than the energy at infinity of any given pair, then you'll form a bound object, you'll find a bound pair, and that pair will merge. Right? So that's the classical way of forming, classical way in GR to form binary black hole mergers. And you can easily calculate what is the characteristic periods in a distance, RSS here I call it, at which you have to be within for two black holes to form a bound system with a velocity dispersion V, right? So you see it depends on C squared or V squared to this power 207. And then you have the RM here, and that is the Schwarzschild radius of your two black holes. So you can see it's the Schwarzschild radius times some factor. And if you plug in, standard values for a globular cluster, you find this, I think, to be about 100 times the Schwarzschild radius, or, you know, in that ballpark. So we'll be able to make mergers if black holes are encountering each other for distances that are much larger than the Schwarzschild radius, but, you know, still not very far from each other. Okay, we have a question. Okay, so we have a question here of if you have binary black hole mergers forming in dense stellar systems, such as clusters here, that are a result of just binary evolution that have not undergone any, you know, scatterings and so forth here. I know of some studies that have been doing this. So as I said, I cannot do it with the prescriptions that we're doing here. Abbas Askar, for example, Mira Gears' group has been doing some work on this, where they actually look at the different population of black hole mergers as a function of redshift, for example. Europe from that, which group are you working in again? Yeah. No, yeah, okay, so it is the same place. Yeah, okay, so you know Mirik, yes, yeah, yeah. Okay, so, I mean, they have been looking at this, right? And you have a small population of binary black holes at very early times that merges due to binary evolution. But that also strongly depends on your binary evolution model and what is the initial condition for these clusters, which is not very well known. Oliver. Yeah, okay, so the follow-up question is, how does that evolve with the time of the cluster? So you have a peak at very early times where there might happen something, but then very, very quickly, the cluster goes into this kind of, semi-stable state where you have all the heavy objects in the center. That happens within maybe a million years or something like that. So it's most of the time, it will look very close to this here, but the distribution of mass will change as a function of time. Of course, you get rid of the most heavy black holes and so forth. But how things are changing as a function of redshift is active research. So that's an excellent question. Yeah. Okay, so I can take now and plot what is the distribution in peak frequency of these gravitation wave capture mergers. And I can just take a distribution of objects, take a density n, velocity dispersion v, and then I can calculate what is the relative rate of single-single encounters. I can calculate exactly what is the peak frequency, what is the eccentricity once they reach, for example, 10 hertz or another number here. And this here is the distribution at assembly, you know, for single-single captures. And you can see that they distribute up here around Desigo, about LIGO here, with a clear peak here. So you might ask, what is setting this lower limit here? And that is the limit of this single-single capture distance. If it's if the two black holes are encountering each other at a larger distance, then you will simply not have a merger, right? So that sets a lower limit here. So you can say that if you're in the future able to probe the lower bound on this distribution here, you might get an idea of approximately what kind of systems are actually producing these mergers. Are globular clusters, nuclear star clusters, for example, have velocity dispersions that are much higher. So in that case, the peak here will be located further up to the right. Okay, so that's we have a question. That's a very good question. Yes and no. In these systems for globular clusters, you will sometimes have mergers that are happening. Well, there's a lot of mergers actually happening inside the cluster. So the question is, do they stay inside the cluster or not? sometimes they will be kicked out just because of gravitational wave radiation kicks. And in many cases, they will be kicked out. Sometimes you can have a second generation black hole merging with another black hole that happens. Okay, I don't know exactly the exact number that they found recently. It depends on the cluster properties, but that's maybe, I don't know, 5-10% of the time, so or less, or something like this, a few percent of the time. Then you can ask, what is the probability that I form, for example, the nearest merger that we saw, gravitational wave 1905-21, where you have two massive black holes that are merging. That probability is extremely low because you need to have two black holes that are formed through, you know, previous mergers, and they also have to meet each other. And then so the probability drops dramatically when you start out to pair objects that have been formed through previous mergers. But I mean, if you see a black hole merging that is that has a mass of 20 solar masses, it's extremely difficult to see if that forms through a previous merger of 2 10 plus 10. It is only really when you pass the mass gap you can start to speculate. And then you can ask, what's the probability that you have, you know, previous mergers also populating that mass? So the probabilities are relatively small here. But if you go to nuclear star clusters, then the probability is much higher because the escape the loss is also very, very much higher. So you can keep many of the black holes inside. So you can grow these black holes to very high masses, and they might actually be able to back react, you can see, on the distribution or the evolution of the system. But the excellent question to leading order here, I don't think about what happens with these black holes once they form. And well, I shouldn't talk too much about it, but we also did some studies on, can you populate this lower mass gap that Jonah was talking about the other day by binary neutron star mergers. And the processes are simply too slow in the globular clusters. You don't have a lot of neutron star mergers, and you certainly don't have a neutron star merger, and then that black hole keeps on interacting with other things, and then it merges. So it's interesting, but it's not a main. Do we have one more question? Yeah. Okay, so we have a question. What is RM here? So RM here is the Schwarzschild radius of one of my black holes. It's equal mass limit. Yeah, exactly, over C squared. Yeah. Okay, so let me keep going here. So the next thing that we can imagine happening is instead of just binaries forming through gravitational wave captures, it could be that binaries are just formed randomly in this distribution here, right? And as you all know, it's impossible to form a binary unless that you get rid of some of the binding energy, right? If all the objects are not bound to each other pairwise initially. So, but this can actually happen. So in this case here, three objects come very close to each other, and just by chance, you could say, one of the objects takes a little bit of energy, and then two objects end up in a binary. And you can calculate the probability for this to happen. So you just form a binary out of fluctuations in your system here, and then you can ask, what is the outcome of this binary? Can I drive it to merger, or what will actually happen? So you can, and what will happen to leading order is that binary here starts to interact with the single objects in your cluster. And we will call this ejected mergers in this presentation here. And this is a figure from one of Dan and I's papers. And we're now gonna describe this process or take a look at the history of this binary black hole merger. Carl Rodriguez has other figures of this where he actually go in and track exactly what objects coming in and interacting. The long pages with you know, tons of complicated, you know, figures. Maybe Jonah even showed one of the, but I remember one showed it yesterday. So binary black holes really go and interact with a lot of stuff inside the cluster. So a simplified way of showing this is shown here. So I have a binary black hole here. It forms through the process I talked about. It interacts with a single. And then after the interaction, what tends to happen is the semi-major axis becomes slightly smaller. Okay, it's stealing a little bit of energy from the binary. And that happens again and again and again and again. And in each scattering, because you're taking out a little bit of energy from the binary, that energy is released as a recoil into the binary in the single. Some point the recoil is so big that it kicks out the binary from the cluster. And then depending on how eccentric it is when it's kicked out, it will be able to merge within a Hubble time.
Okay.
And if you go in and look at some of these scatterings, actually, you saw one of the figures yesterday. They are quite complicated, right? But even though they're very complicated, they give rise to some well-defined outcome distributions, both in terms of how much energy that's lost, in terms of how close the two of the three objects get to each other in a given time, and so forth. It has really well-defined distributions that really helps us to calculate the outcome of these otherwise very complicated systems. Okay, so just an illustration of why this cluster channel is actually important to consider or interesting is that we look at equation A here. I can calculate, so if the semi-major axis changes by a fraction delta in each scattering here, I can calculate exactly how much energy that's released in each three-body scattering. And from that, I can calculate what is the characteristic semi-major axis A, e.g., the ejection, such that the binary is being kicked out of the cluster if the cluster has an escape velocity v. Okay, so this here is the one that are down here. So when it reaches this value here, the recoil will be so big that it's kicked out of the cluster. Okay, I can just calculate it directly from Newtonian dynamics. I can also calculate more or less what can the maximum semi-major axis be, because if it's too big, the two objects will not be bound compared with the rest of the objects. So it basically corresponds to the semi-major axis, which the orbital velocity is comparable with the velocity of the objects inside the cluster, the dispersion velocity here. And then I can calculate how long time it takes for a binary black hole to undergo its next scattering. That is 1 divided by the rate of scatterings, and the rate is n sigma v. The sigma is the cross section for another object to come in, the n is the density, and v is the velocity dispersion. So I can now say, well, what is the total time it takes for a binary black hole to start out here until it's being kicked out? And I can integrate up all the times here, and I find the time here, t ejection time, and that turns out to be around 10 to the 7 if I take put in values here for observed globular clusters. And so it takes about 10 million years for a binary black hole to form to be kicked out. And if you sum over all the globular clusters that you have in a local area and so forth, you end up with a merger rate. If you assume all of those binary black holes actually merge outside the cluster, that merger rate is very close to the rate that you see from LIGO. Right? Yeah, we have a question. All right. No. Yeah. No, it is, I take all these, okay, so the question is if there's any special other interaction with the cluster, if this is can be doing these calculations. Oh, okay, there is one very important is that the binary black holes in each scattering, they are being kicked further and further out in the cluster, right? Because the kick becomes larger and larger. And what actually brings them back into the center is two-body scatterings with only stars out in the halo. They kind of cool down and end up in the cluster core again. Okay, so that is a very important process. If you didn't have any other objects, this one here would just stay on a very long orbit, and it's not even clear that the time scales that I put out here makes any sense. So that is important, yeah. Okay, so if you again just follow that exercise and calculate what is the distribution of these ejected mergers, you end up with this blue curve here, right? And I said to you, they will all circularize before they reach the LIGO band. So it would be very difficult for them to, for us to tell the difference between such mergers and mergers forming through other channels, isolated binaries and so forth, because they pop into the LIGO band with, following the you know, same tracks as probably any other binary black hole merger. So a small intermezzo here I want to make. So you can ask if these scatterings are completely, you know, chaotic, or is there any, you know, structure in this here? And there were some people at the Institute for Advanced Study about 30 years ago that did some early calculations that found maybe some pattern in the distribution of outcomes. So what they did here was looking at, so I'll make it short here, you can come and talk to me afterwards, but they're looking at the outcome as a function of the phase of your binary and the incoming, the impact parameter here, they call it rho, I call it B here. So that's a way to show, you know, to vary parts of the problem, look at the distribution. And then the distribution or the different symbols here are different outcomes. So for example, blue and red can escape, or red and red can escape, or red and green can escape, and so forth. So you see like a structure here. So we did it a similar one with much higher resolution here. You can see here, and in the regions here where you have like this constant color here, those correspond to these prompt ejections. So things is coming in, is promptly ejected out again. When you reach the limit here between the prompt and then this coarse-grained area here, when you approach the limit here, the third object, the red one here, do not get kicked. So the kick that it gets smaller and smaller and smaller as it reaches this limit here, exactly on this boundary here, the kick that it receives is close to zero. So it goes out on an infinitely long orbit. But once you crossed here, it is not able to escape the binary. It will return, and you have these complicated things going on. That's why you get into these more chaotic regions. Then there are some belts with the black hole mergers and other things. We can also take and zoom in and ask if these regions are really truly chaotic, and they are not. You keep having structures and bands and so on. So that's kind of funny. Yeah. The B is the impact, basically means that it is the perpendicular distance between the center of mass of your binary and your third object at infinity. So if you go out in the third object is out here, then it will come in here, and it will, the B remains constant until it starts, until its orbit is perturbed by the binary, and then I put in higher order terms. So all of the red dots are actually mergers that are happening during my scattering. So the black one are mergers that are happening during a prompt scattering. So the third object is just coming in and plunging directly into the black holes. So I do have some higher order. Yeah. Oh, that's absolutely true. Oh yeah, so that is absolutely true. So you actually tend to kick out. You're absolutely right. You kick out more singles than you kick out binaries. Yeah, so you lose over time. We did some studies of that where you can calculate how much do I lose as a function of time for the different components. And I don't remember exactly what the factor is. It's not a factor of 100, maybe a factor of, you know, a couple. Because again the masses are similar, right? So maybe a factor of 2 you end up losing. Yeah, we have one more question. Oh, so we get a question about the maximum luminosity. So we can map that to eccentricity. So okay, so that is a very good question. What I have shown here is the distribution of eccentricity, and some of them will enter the LIGO band with the eccentricity of 0.99, for example. In that case, the luminosity for this gravitational wave peak frequency that I talked about is not very high, actually, because the total luminosity from the system is distributed over many, many modes. So instead of having, you know, just a one frequency as you have from a binary black hole, which is 1/T, you distribute your power into a lot of different frequencies. And I have some figures with Dan in one of our papers where you see the distribution. And to make the answer short, the problem with these highly centric is exactly the luminosity is not super high if they're very centric. So that makes it more, even more difficult to see them at large distances. Now, I think we should wait with a few of the in the class, which, and because I have many more slides, and you can also talk to me there. Yeah. Then we can move on to one more way we can imagine binary black holes to form very dense stellar systems. And that is that maybe the eccentricity of your binary here can be excited to a very high value such that it merges before it undergoes its next scattering. Right? So I try to illustrate it here. You have a scattering going on. Oh, it merges before the next third object is coming in. So what is the condition in this case here? I can write out a perfect closed form probability distribution for this problem as well. What I simply say is that, well, this merger can only happen if the lifetime of my assembled binary, where E here is eccentricity and that change in the scattering, if the eccentricity or if the lifetime is shorter than the interaction time scale. Okay, and that's 1 over this rate, it's a set, so N sigma B. So this number I have, and this one here changes as a function of time because eccentricity is being changed and so forth. If I assume a distribution of eccentricity, I'll not come into it here, but in E scattering, that distribution of eccentricity goes as about 2e. I can then calculate what is the probability in each scattering that the merger or the binary black hole will emerge before it's undergoing its next scattering. And then I can integrate again over all the chances that it has here, integrate a total probability and find some final expression for that probability. Right? So now we have reduce this relative complicated problems, multiple scatterings and all the things to actually a closed form. And we find things that are very close to what people now find using more, full simulations of this problem here. And so for a binary, for a distribution of black holes in a, relative classical cluster, you get the distribution of peak frequency looking like this for these, what we call two body mergers. And you can see many of them will actually appear eccentric in the LIGO, in the LISA band. So once we have LISA operating, we have LIGO operating, and we can start to cross-correlate not only things that are first coming from the LISA band, then driving into the LIGO band. We can also start to correlate the different eccentric sources in the different bands, right? And that will put very tight constraints on the properties of these merging systems. Some of them are highly eccentric. Many of them merge on relatively short timescales. So, just when they form, they're highly eccentric. But you also capture some of them when they're not so eccentric. So you have a distribution of eccentricities. Yeah. I don't have it in this presentation, but you have that. Yeah. Okay. So then let's go to the next one. And I already showed you this movie here yesterday, but more or less the final thing that we can come up with is when we zoom even more into the problem is what if the binaries can merge during the triple interaction, right? So first we said they can merge after outside the cluster, then we said in between the scatterings. Now we go even closer and say during the scatterings. So let's see what the properties of this here is. And what we have here is a simple in-body code where we put in what's called the post-Newtonian correction term here. Now this one here appears. Okay, so and that takes into account gravitation wave radiation. So if two of the three objects come very close to each other, you can see here enough gravitation waves can be radiated that they simply merge during your triple scattering. Okay, and you might think, well, the probability for that is very small. It is true, but you can also see you have many, many chances of undergoing very close encounter because it's so chaotic. So sometimes it's goes on for hundreds of resonating states here. Sometimes it's prompt, sometimes it takes a long time. So especially these here are very difficult to simulate for all kind of pairs and mass ratios and clusters. But we can also using simple arguments calculate what the probability for this merger is. and even the distribution in eccentricity, but the probability goes as follows. You can think about in a simple way. You can say, well, in the problem of single-single captures, the energy radiated over the first orbit for the two black holes to undergo a merger has to be about the relative energy of your black holes inside the cluster, which is half mv squared. In this case, we have three objects. Instead of having the binding energy or the relative energy of your black holes inside the cluster, I just take the binding energy of my binary that I start out with. You know, you can put it in other ways. You can say, well, you can also say that the merger time of my binary black hole has to be comparable with the orbital time of my binary black hole. If it's much longer, the third object will just perturb the system, right? So I can then get basically a capture distance for my binary single mergers that I showed here. And that scales here with the semi-major axis of my binary and also here with the Schwarzschild radius. And then with this information, that is the condition for a single binary to merge during my scattering. But you can see it's very chaotic. So how do we deal with that problem? We deal with it in the following way, that we describe the binary single interaction as a series of temporary binary single states, where you have a binary with a bound single, binary with a bound single, binary with a bound single. And it keeps on doing this pulsating thing, right? And in each of these, we then ask, will this merge before the third one come back? Will this merge before the third one come back? And then we will integrate up the probability over all the resonating states. And the number here we call n. And you know, with all the information I gave you, you can just write out the probability of these mergers to form during the scattering. And we can even, in this case, put out a closed form solution. Okay, so we can even calculate the, you know, how it depends on the velocity dispersion of your clusters, how many eccentric mergers will you get in LIGO, LISA, DESIGO, depending on the properties of the clusters. If we do this exercise here and I just plug in where they're going to form, they're going to form up here, so very close to the LIGO band. So many of these will be highly eccentric in the LIGO band. I said a couple of years ago, we had a summer school here. So it was a little bit different format. It was 7 weeks and people had to work on different projects. And I showed this the movie the other day. But Mike Sevin, one of the students, he chose to work on this problem where I said, well, let us say we have binary scattering instead of binary singles. And so the thing is that you don't have that many binary black holes in a cluster at any given time. You maybe have 5 or 10 where you have thousands of singles. So the argument, there are different arguments, but one of the arguments is that if you have too many binaries, we just split the cluster apart because they generate so much heat. So it's like it's a self-regulating process. You don't have that many binaries. So the probability of a binary is relatively small, but once you have binary, then a lot of things going on. You know? So maybe you can form a lot of these highly eccentric mergers through binary. And he found that the binary do not dominate over binary single generated highly eccentric mergers, but you know, maybe about 30% of the, you know, it will increase the number by 30% or something like that. So it is still very important, could dominate in other systems. So that's very interesting. Okay, so this part here, I will finish with giving a little other way of thinking about this problem here. So as you have seen, we have different distributions for different outcomes. And then you can ask, well, why do they, you know, tend up to pile into such different regions? How can I understand why are they there? It sounds really weird. We saw these equations. What did I learn from this? But it is actually all about characteristic timescales. So if you have a binary black hole inside a very dense stellar system, there is a characteristic length scale, and the length scale for a global cluster is about 1 AU. You have a binary, so, you know, most binary black holes inside clusters is having a separation about of order AU. And then you can ask, what should the pericenter be, or the eccentricity be, such that a binary with 1 AU separation should merge within a time tau here, or t the symbol T here. And then from that condition, you can calculate what will the corresponding peak frequency be, right? So then I can first say, well, if you have binaries kicked out of a cluster, they have to merge within a Hubble time. If I plug in the Hubble time here, I can calculate what should the peak frequency be if the semi-major axis is about this, characteristic here, we put it through to 0.5, but you can see it depends very weakly on this exact number. And then you find that the peak frequency will be about 10 to the minus 5. That is why they're peaking here. So if they're lower, they will not merge. And then you can do the same exercise. What is the characteristic timescale for binary black holes merging inside the cluster in between the scatterings, 1 over n sigma v? You have another timescale. You put that in. Is that 10 to the 7 or 10 to the 6? You put it in. You get another peak frequency here. And then for the final one here, the characteristic timescale for binary black holes merging doing triple scatterings are the orbital timescale of your binary you start out with. You plot that in about 1 year, 0.1 year, you get out with a value for the peak frequency here. So what you actually see here is just a mapping in peak frequency space of the characteristic timescales of your system with a little spread on top. Dan, how much time do I have left? Okay. Yeah, let's add that to the discussion section. Then I'll just finish with some work that I did with Adrian Hammers. So because all of the things that I talked about here involves only strong scatterings, right? You have a binary, a strong scattering, a single object is coming in, something violent happened. But you have many more scatterings where you have a single object not coming in directly impacting the binary, but just raising the binary or a much larger distance, right? So what is the outcome of this? Is this something that we have to worry about? And that's, of course, another important ingredient in trying to understand the evolution of binaries in very thin stellar systems. So there has been a classical calculation of what happens if you have a binary black hole or a binary star and a third object coming in on a parabolic orbit. And you can calculate to leading order what's going to happen is that the eccentricity of your binary is changing over that single orbit, right? So now you can imagine, well, if you have hundreds of these weak scatterings, will you be able to slowly random walk the eccentricity into some very high eccentricity which will drive the binary black hole to merge on a very short time scale? Is that important to take into account? Yes or no? Okay, so people have been arguing for a long time, well, it's not very important because delta E is extremely small, maybe 0.01 and blah, blah, blah. So we don't have to think about that. But if you think about mergers, binary black hole mergers that are about to merge or actually are important for the merger channel inside globular clusters, the binary black hole, it has to merge within, is undergoing its next scattering, then the eccentricity has to be about 0.99, otherwise it won't merge, right? So now the problem is actually, are these weak scatterings, are they important from that perspective? Because now the change in eccentricity don't have to be big for actually giving rise to a big outcome, right? Because if it's 0.99 sitting in the cluster waiting to merge, but there is another object coming in and perturbing it by 0.05 in eccentricity to a smaller value, it will not merge, for example, right? So what we did here, Hammers and I, we calculated some second order effects to this problem here. I was able to solve the change in eccentricity from perturbing black holes if the binary black hole already is highly eccentric. And that was the limit that was not well described by this classical calculation by Hetty and Ratio. And some of the effects that that Smadar was actually talking about do take place in this case as well here. So you have orbit flipping, you have excitation of eccentricity, but it's not happening on cyclical timescales. It is happening on the orbital timescale as a single one passes the binary. Okay. So one of the main questions that we ask ourselves is that if you start out with a binary black hole inside your cluster, is sitting there, it's about to merge, it has been perturbed to 0.99 in eccentricity. Everybody is waiting for this to merge, but now there's a single object coming in, changing in eccentricity, and in linear theory, the older version of the analytical stuff here, predicts that the eccentricity, the change in eccentricity is maybe 0.2, for example. Right? Now you see, if you add 0.2 to 0.99, you will exceed one. What is happening in this case? Well, we did find that what happens is that the orbit flips around and you end up with an eccentricity that's smaller than what you ended up with. So you don't just disrupt the binary more. Can think about this as a reflective boundary here. It goes up and then it reflects off and then you end up at another value here. But then you can also ask, well, when it goes up here, will it then reach one? Will it merge during the weak perturbation? In that case, we also found that is most of case not true, right? So you can see the blue one here is before the perturbation, is sitting there in the cluster waiting to merge a single object to come close by. And then it quickly flips around on a very, very short time scale here. So it goes up here and down here, but it's not really going full orbit around. So you don't get a Pearson in the distance approaching one, zero. So you end up with some final state here. Okay. And what can also happen in this case here, as Madame was talking about, we had some questions about it, is that you can have effects from GR precession. So if you have a high precession of your binary, in this case, as a third object comes by, it might shield itself in the sense that it might persist so fast that the perturbation from the single one coming by is not really important. It is important in the Sigler case that Smadar was talking about, but we found that the third object has to be really, really far away, moving relatively slowly relative to the binary here for that effect to be important in this case. So one and two post-Newtonian correction terms are not really important in our case, but the radiation term only tends to really be important after the scattering takes place once you end up with some final eccentricity here. So my last slide would be then, we then followed a binary black hole inside a cluster. And then you have all the all the red crosses here is every time that the binary undergoes a strong scattering, single one comes in. That's the one most people are looking at, the outcome of that we also spend most of our time on, where the gray one are the perturbation from all the small single scatterings that are on the cluster. And this here is the eccentricity of the binary black hole. And here is the peak frequency. And to take a look at these two here. And this here is where LISA is sensitive. What we found in this case here is that you keep undergoing scatterings. And in this case here, the binary black hole was actually driven to merger by these weak scatterings that are exciting the eccentricity, and it drives us into the LISA band. Okay. And the main conclusion from this study here was that you can enhance the number of mergers, of eccentric mergers appearing in the LISA band if you take these higher order effects into account in the problem, the weak. But there's still a lot of things to be done in this problem. And so I wanted to finish up saying that the main takeaway from this one here is that for clusters, you get this rich distribution across peak frequency, across eccentricity, and there is tons of things not only to be learned about clusters, but you can also tell the difference between such systems, isolated binaries, and so forth. And if somebody want to hear more about this, so we could maybe take it Wednesday or Thursday, I prepared also a lot of slides on how to tell the difference between channels that are producing eccentric mergers. Of course, clusters is not the only one. You heard Smadar was talking about, and there's many others. So we have some new ideas to distinguish eccentric formation channels as well. So if somebody is interested about that, we can follow up on that on Wednesday and Thursday. So I'll stop here. Thanks.
Yeah, I think we should compile questions for Johan in the Slack. I think now we should take a 20-minute break, but we should compile questions and we can discuss all of these ideas and what Johan already talked about on Wednesday or Thursday morning and over break and lunch. So for now, let's take a 20-minute break.
Sure.